So you've probably heard about Affinity lately. It's been everywhere this past week after they launched version 3.0, which combines what used to be three separate programs, Vector, Pixel, and Layout. Basically, that's Illustrator, Photoshop, and InDesign all in one app. And the biggest headline here is that it's free. Free for everyone and forever. And that's pretty wild. I mean, there should be a catch here, right? It appears not. So I've been getting a lot of messages asking, should I then switch to Affinity? Is it reliable? Is it as good as Photoshop for architecture uses? So in this video, I want to give you my honest thoughts. I've spent a couple of hours testing it on a few renders, trying to see if I could actually replace Photoshop for at least post-production in architecture. Use Affinity for post-production. And this is my first impression of Affinity. I'll share what worked, what didn't, and well, what I think about this whole free forever idea. But before we get into it, I think we gotta make something clear here. I might be biased. Photoshop has been with me for so many years. I mean, not sponsored anything, just I've been using so much for renderings, diagrams, blends, even illustrations. It's basically like an extra arm. For me at this point, an extension of how I work. Whatever I create digitally, and honestly, physically too, it goes through Photoshop. It's where I fine-tune colors, tweak light. I really go into the specifics of an image and give their final look. So replacing it is not something that I can take lightly. Still, I'm really happy that Adobe finally has some serious competition. Up to this point, yes, Affinity was there, but it was still a paid product. Cheaper, sure, but I mean, V1 and V2 had its flaws, and switching like that isn't as simple as it is. But now that it's free and it's getting even better, it's definitely worth talking about. So, first off, I tested Affinity in the same kind of workflow that I usually do in Photoshop, like bringing the base renders, layering adjustments, masks, and really blending in extra elements. And by the way, these images here are from our Carbono House. There's a full video about it here on YouTube on our channel. I'll leave a link in the video description if you're interested. So in Affinity, there's definitely a learning curve, but a lot of what you already know from Photoshop carries over naturally, like layers, adjustments, blending modes. Like, I mean, they all work pretty much the same way. So I focused here on the Pixel workspace, which is basically the equivalent of Photoshop. And honestly, I tried to look at it with fresh eyes, but it's not as easy to do that. And it's hard not to compare. You inevitably end up searching for familiar tools and shortcuts. Really, the way that you did in Photoshop, how can I do that in Affinity? So I really spent some time looking like, how do I do this, but in Affinity? And well, there's some material out there, though not much yet. And I think this is something to consider, but I'll touch on it at the end of the video. Overall, the workflow feels very familiar. Like layers behave similarly, masks work almost the same, and there's a brush system here as well. I mean, you can even import your Photoshop brushes, so all of your .abr files directly into Affinity. You can open PSDs in Affinity. I mean, this sort of barrier that could have existed doesn't, and I think this is huge. What really stood out to me is how non-destructive everything is in Affinity by default. The program kind of assumes that you're going to have to tweak something in the future, so that it gives you that full control over your edits later down the road. And I liked how intuitive the adjustment layers are. I mean, there's a bunch of them. Everything is accessible here on this layer tab. And you can apply them to a specific layer or just globally. Really cool. And you always keep the option to tweak them later. I mean, as it's supposed to be, but seeing how it works really well is definitely a positive point. However, not everything is perfect. Affinity felt a little bit buggy at times. For example, when I was working with masks, sometimes the updates were a little bit delayed or kind of laggy. Like you would paint the mask and then it takes maybe a second and a half or two, like to show up. And it's not a huge deal, but it sort of adds a little bit of friction to the process. Maybe this is something that can be fixed in the future. But okay, so from a first look, it checked a lot of the boxes for a post-production workflow. I could say that, yeah, if I didn't have Photoshop, I could definitely use Affinity. But this is just simple things, you know, adjustments, layers, and everything. I wanted to push a little bit further. So after that, I wanted to test something that has been used a lot recently in architectural post-production, blending an AI-enhanced version of the image with the base render. This is usually just a simple mask job, and well, it worked just as expected. And I also tested using the material ID render channel to make quick selections with something sort of like the magic wand. Again, pretty straightforward, everything worked really fine. This magic one for isolating areas like the vegetation or really the facade here. This process is really familiar, very quick, very simple. Apart from that, like mask delay that I mentioned, but everything worked fine. One thing that didn't work as planned was handling smart objects, or rather the lack of them. Because in Photoshop, smart objects are one of the core reasons post-production is so flexible and so you can really achieve complex looks with it. For example, in Photoshop, I can group a few layers, trim them into a smart object, and then quickly send that chunk to another file like the subfile, work with that summed up version, that added version as a non-destructive file, and then use external tools like Google Banana or Crea AI to adjust people or enhance textures and do that in sort of like a subfile that is part of a like a larger file. I like this system. I could just then go back and everything stays linked and updated. In Affinity, that process doesn't exist. So, I mean, sure, you could find workarounds and learn and use it in different ways. But I felt that, just again, coming from Photoshop, I felt that this was missing. And I read through some forums and it really seemed like it's not an option right now. Maybe what exists in the future, or maybe I just didn't find it. And if that's the case, comment down below. But not having smart objects certainly makes the process, the workflow here, a little bit trickier. The workaround that I found here was just to copy that specific area with this person that I wanted to enhance, and then send that to Nano Banana, just process it separately, and then paste it back in. So everything in this sort of main file, and you had to align it manually using the selection with the snapping here, which worked really well. Something that I liked, that the selections, they have a very strong snapping. So this is kind of interesting for this type of work. So it does work. It feels a little bit clunky. It feels like we're just dealing with this main file only. And you kind of lose that smooth, non-destructive loop with subfiles. Still, groups here function as sort of their own nests in a way. Adjustments only apply to the group itself. So again, inherently non-destructive. And then for smaller edits, like adding a glare, vignetting, or soft light effects, Affinity handles it fine. Like you can use brushes, blend modes, all of that is there. Now, one big thing that I felt was missing, and that I think a lot of us rely on, is having something like the camera raw filter in Photoshop. Architectural renders are, in a way, like digital photos. So you always want that final layer of control, the ability to adjust colors, like in-depth and advanced way, clarity, contrast, color grading, subtle tones, all in one place. And Affinity has something similar called Develop Persona, if I'm not mistaken, which gives you access to raw adjustments, but it's much simpler. It feels more like something built for photographers working with actual cameras and raw files, not so much for all types of images where you want to go deep, for example, in illustrations, like you have that layered control over every part of it. And in our case here, the render. For example, in Photoshop's Camera Raw, something that I use it so much is the color mixer, where you can tweak each color channel independently, like saturation, luminancy, the hue, everything in a single place. So you can use that to tweak greens and yellows for vegetation, something that we do very often. And in Affinity, there's no direct equivalent. I mean, you can do something similar, but just stacking multiple effects, like an HSL adjustment here, like maybe a selective color there, but it's all fragmented and it feels a little bit more like the base type of adjustment layers. You've got to be then constantly jumping between tools to achieve what just one of these panels in Photoshop can do. And while I'm not saying that this is just way better in Photoshop and not good in Affinity, I'm just saying that these are things that you kind of look for, that you got used to it, that maybe you will need to adapt if you're looking to really migrate to Affinity. Affinity also has like a bunch of things that Photoshop doesn't have. For example, a clarity slider has its own standalone slider, which is great. You can also add a noise as a separate live filter, which is way more flexible than Photoshop's way of doing it. And like if you wanted to something like that, you have to go through a 50% gray layer, smart objected, overlay, and then add the effect. Now, I think something worth mentioning is that performance-wise thing. I mean, with the masks, I noticed a little bit of delay, a little bit of a lag. Affinity felt overall slower, especially on large, high-resolution renders. I'm working with a 6K image here. And then when I zoomed out, the image turned pixelated, probably to save some performance. Maybe you can disable this, but on a 4K screen, it's very noticeable. And then you zoom in and it takes a moment to like the things sharpen again, like maybe half a second, and it's definitely not a deal breaker, but it's distracting. The same goes for the masks and the sliders, especially the sliders. They felt a little bit laggy, like a bit, little bit clunky. Like you move a slider, it feels like it jumps instead of gliding smoothly. And it breaks a little bit of that sense of flow and that precise control over the settings and adjustments. So I could spend way more just testing every aspect of Affinity and really diving into it. But I wanted to give you my first impression and also open a space of discussion in the comments, because honestly, I'm really excited to see a competitor stepping up against Adobe. The monopoly Adobe has had for years hasn't really been healthy. We all know that for the market, especially in terms of their aggressive pricing. So seeing Affinity not only catch up, but also challenge them with a product that's free for everyone, that's a big deal. And they even made this announcement like a day before or after, something like this, like right with their Adobe Max reveal with the new feature. So they're going against Adobe hard. Affinity looks and feels solid with lots of potential. I mean, some important things are missing. There's some lagging and bugging in some areas, but I think Affinity is going to evolve. Give it 6 months, maybe a year, and we might see a different software. I mean, we're not mentioning here all of the generative AI stuff from Adobe. We're not comparing that side to side. We're actually just looking at the free version of Affinity, right? Which kind of gets me worried, because free forever for everyone slogan does sound amazing, but I'm a bit skeptical, to be honest. If it's something is truly free, maybe you're the product. I don't know. I mean, Affinity now belongs to Canva, and then Canva has its own AI ecosystem, which is paid. So it makes me wonder if this free tier will eventually be limited, or if the updates and new features will later go behind a paywall and it will be so, so limited that it will only be for hobbyists or something. And it's not the same as a truly open source software like Blender, for example, where the community also drives the updates. Here, it feels more like a business decision. They're like trying to get the audience on board, and then later they're going to switch it up. I don't know. So the big question here, should you stop paying for Adobe and switch to Affinity? That's a tough question, but from a first glance, I see that if your workflow is simple, like if you mainly use Photoshop, Illustrator, or InDesign for lighter work, then yes, I mean, you can absolutely give Affinity a try. It's stable enough, capable enough, and free. So there's nothing to lose here. But then if you depend on deeper tools like the camera raw, smart objects, and even I've seen that automations is not something in Affinity, and you want more of the generative AI stuff, I'd say that stay with Adobe for now, for the speed, maybe for the consistency, and especially for the ecosystem. Maybe that's worth the price. I mean, not that Adobe doesn't have any bugs or crashes, it has a lot of those. Now, one thing that I think is really important for you to consider and take into account before making the switch, while researching and trying to do the images, I saw that the learning resources from Affinity are still very limited. Like the forums are kind of active and there's a few tutorials out there, but from older versions, and that doesn't really translate to the new V3 version yet. And even the official guides aren't even updated. Not for too long, obviously, I believe. And there's even channels coming out from talking about Affinity. So we're going to have a lot of material there, but for now, you might feel like you're a bit on your own. And as for me, I mean, Photoshop is such an extension, as I said, of my creative skills, and I rely so much on the integration of Adobe Premiere Pro and Adobe After Effects for the videos I create here for YouTube, for the courses, and really to express myself through video, not only with the 2D images. I'll keep an eye on all of this for sure. I will have Affinity on my PC here and try to use it from time to time. But personally, I won't be making the switch, for now at least. But still, again, I'm really happy that this is happening. It's good for the industry. It pushes the competition. It pushes pricing, especially. And it gives people more options. So those are my first impressions of Affinity 3.0. And I would love to hear yours now, because honestly, I learned a lot from you guys in the comments below. This was just my opinion and how I felt about this new software, but I know there's so many variables into this. So if you've tested, if you're using it already, and maybe you already dropped Adobe, or you're considering making the switch, drop your thoughts in the comments below. Let's make this sort of like a discussion point for architecture with Affinity. All right, that's it for this video. Subscribe to not miss any future videos about architectural visualization and representation, really visual communication. And I'll see you guys in the next one.